Michael, Tyler's transformation. Really intense stuff.
Yeah, it's by far the most I've been challenged as an actor. I'm glad that we didn't rush into it. It was written really late, and we had Marco Siega, who I'm very close with, and who I trusted him 100%. And we had an amazing crew, and we shot in a close set. And I was in a very vulnerable state the whole time, but there took a lot. I mean, at least a few weeks of preparation to get there. One day of rehearsal before, and we shot it in 2 days, two back-to-back days that were about 14 hours of me just. It chained up and pretty much naked. So it's if it wasn't for the crew that we have there, and honestly, I wouldn't have been able to do it if it wasn't for Candice, because the things that you don't see behind the scenes that aren't in the script, for me to get there emotionally over 2 days, it's like a marathon, and you can run out of gas, and so you don't want to overexert yourself. And Candice helped me in that, where, in scenes where she's kind of telling me to calm down, there was no dialogue there, wasn't in the script, but she just took it upon herself to kind of just talk to me in her soft little voice, right in my ear, and just kind of tell me to calm down, it's okay, and it really did help me, and if it wasn't for little things like that, I wouldn't have got there as easy, so I want to say thank you for that, lovely. But, and at the end of the day, it was amazing that in the post-production, all the CGI work, the sound, and the way everything was edited together, it was really good, and I'm happy with it.
We really wanted to make sure that that Tyler's transformation, the werewolf transformation, was as much of a human experience as it was anything else, and, sort of messed with his head a little bit, but really it's very true. We likened it to labor, it's waves and waves of contractions and most tremendous pain you ever feel that kind of like come over you and then release for a little while, and you're just going through it again and again, and it's the most vulnerable place you can be, and it's really a true sort of shedding your skin as an adolescent and coming into your own as a man at the moment. I'm getting all like wacky poetic about it, but for him to, it's the acting that carried that whole sequence. We had some cool arm breaking and a bat ripple and some sound effects to really bring it out, but it really was his willingness to just expose himself to that level and to kind of vomit it all out there that made it work. So, thank you.
So, how much of that was CGI and you did the lenses, right?
We have manufactured for him that we then accentuate sometimes in like certain tight close-up shots with little CGI. Fangs are applied.
Yeah, they're fitted. I got so nobody else can really wear them. They just pop right in on my K-19. Can I get those, by the way, at the end of the season? Or is that somebody else's property, or can I?
When you die, you can take them home with you.
Well, you can keep them forever.
And then, of course, the hand breaking and back ripple, and then the full wolf shot were all computer generated by entity artifacts house. But the rest of it was a lot of the stuff where his limbs are flying all around and added sounds of bones breaking and all that was actually just what we call actor action.
Did you have a big discussion about before you showed the wolves, like how you would show them? It's like being human, it's all CGI, it's kind of the manual.
Yeah.
But
you do it again.
By the end of it. So was there a large? Did you talk a lot?
Oh,
about
yeah.
That?
I mean, Kevin and I, one of our shining professional moments as friends and partners, made this little gem called Cursed, which is a werewolf movie that had a gazillion-dollar werewolf design in which a gazillion dollars of, CGI were created to do what, at the time, between Rick Baker and the guys at K&B and Kevin wanted to be a kind of groundbreaking idea, which is a werewolf that could both be sort of like a four-legged creature and a two-legged creature. So it wasn't wolf-man, or it wasn't wolf, it was something in between. And we learned so many painful and unbelievable lessons from that process. And the very first thing we said is we cannot rely on visual effects to tell this story, not on a TV schedule, not on a TV budget. And, you know, our whole show is grounded in almost like a biological reality, as silly as that might sound, that, you know, the rules of the vampires, the way the witches tap into nature for their spells, and we wanted to make sure that the werewolves were the same thing. And so while there is a mystical element to the transformation itself, the animal itself is a wolf. Of course, that comes with its own set of problems, but right. Here are they.
Wolf-rangers. I had a reader that wanted to know, Candice, how does it affect blood test?
It depends what recipe. there's all kinds of recipes. There's sugar-free unsettled jello is one, which actually isn't as bad as it sounds. There's also just kind of that naked juice. They do berry and they add different juices to it. Sometimes it's just straight up corn syrup. That's the ickiest one. It's just a little too thick and sweet on the tongue, but it's an interesting thing when they're concocting all these blood recipes.
All right, Julie, how important was it to have Caroline experience the transformation with Tyler?
Beyond for them as a team, as a friendship. For Caroline as a character, for Tyler as a character. You know, it's funny, I was talking earlier today about Uncle Mason and how tragic it was to have to kill off such a fine-looking young man. And, you know, but the whole point was that we knew we wanted Tyler to be all alone when this came around. The biggest, most life-altering experience, personally and physically for him, and he was going to have nobody. No father, no mentor, no friend, and that would pave way for an unlikely friend to step in and help him through it. And you know, Caroline's whole journey is everybody thought she was so selfish in season one and kind of self-centered, but in reality she just kind of loves too much and cares too much and just wants people to connect with her. And that's been kind of her Achilles heel as a human, which became sort of her greatest asset as a vampire, which is that she was able to step into a really perilous situation and be this kid's friend and be there for him. And, you know, that's what I thought was so beautiful about it. It was just the bond of two unlikely supernatural creatures that shouldn't be in the same room with each other on a full moon, and yet her unwillingness to leave him, not wanting him to be alone.